Mellow music plays as we open on a man laying down a cloth before pouring himself a drink. He takes some water and runs his finger around the rim of the glass before putting it down, wrapping it in the cloth, and smashing it with a cane. He then pours the shattered glass into a pair of slippers before putting the same slippers onto his bare feet. He walks with the cane into a large empty house. 60s pop music plays as Stephen Grant wakes up. He undoes the restraint on his right ankle before walking away from his bed, which is surrounded by a small frame of sand. Stephen calls his mother while feeding his one-finned goldfish, Gus. He finishes and leaving a voicemail on his mom's phone. As he leaves his home, briefly interrupted by a broom vendor right outside his door, Stephen catches a bus to the British Museum in London, which is showcasing an exhibit on ancient Egypt. He explains mummification to a young girl to get the ritual, but is interrupted by his boss Donna, who calls him Stevie. He corrects her to call him Stephen. She scolds him for tour guiding when he should be focused on selling gifts from the shop. Another associate approaches Stephen to ask if they are still on for steak at 7 o'clock the next night. He cannot recall and assumes the woman is asking him out. She giggles and walks away as Donna comes back and asks him what a vegan would eat in a steakhouse. When he rebuffs her remark, she walks away. Later, as they are closing, Donna continues to scold Stephen for constantly being late, which is why she assigned him to inventory. He tries to point out some of the historical inaccuracies of what they are selling at the museum, but Donna refuses to listen. He tells her that the Ennead is comprised of 9 Egyptian gods, but only 7 are present in the picture they are selling. Donna jokes about the mistake and continues to throw insults at Stephen before dismissing him. As he leaves, Stephen says goodbye to a security guard, who greets him as Scotty, to which Stephen replies, "It's Stephen with V." As he eats, he explains his sleepwalking to a gold-painted street performance mime, who looks strikingly like the man who donned the glass-filled slippers at the start. Stephen helps the performer out by tipping him and helping him get tips for pictures with tourists in between his rants. He reaches the conclusion that he will need to overcome his sleepwalking if he will commit to a girlfriend. He tips the mime once more before leaving, shown in the reflection of a puddle, as a green leaf land on it and causing ripples. Stephen spreads the sand around his bed and locks each of the locks on his door. He attaches his ankle restraint, begins to listen to a podcast on staying awake while he fiddles with a Rubik's Cube. Clips show him doing other activities to keep his mind awake, like reading about the Ennead. As the podcast suggests reading a book, a way of keeping the mind awake, Stephen hears the words, "Think of yourself as a part of the story." He suddenly wakes up in a field of grass in great pain over his jaw. He stands up, hears a voice telling him to go back to sleep, and he is told to surrender the body to Stephen. When he doesn't understand, the voice says the idiot is in control. Stephen removes a gold scarab from his pocket as a figure approaches him from behind carrying a staff. He turns around, sees that he is trespassing on a castle's property, and is shot at by its guards. And the voice tells him to run away. He runs away as the guards pursue him, missing with every shot they take. And he comes to a part of the town where Harrow, a man with long hair, in a dark red outfit, again similar looking to glass-filled slippers dude, is being greeted by the people who clear a path for him. The man leads all the townspeople to the open town square, where he comments on the beauty of the day with an American accent. He tells the people that their job is to make the earth feel as much like heaven as possible. Asks who wants to go first. A random man approaches and is greeted by Harrow, who commends him on offering his soul for judgment, waiting to serve our goddess even before she wakes. Harrow places the cane in the man's hands as he performs a ritual to judge the name in the name of Ammit, the Egyptian funerary deity, a god of death. Stephen and the other townspeople watch on as Harrow's scale tattoo on his right arm glows slightly before he declares the person is a good man and hugs him. The guards continue to search for Stephen amongst the spectators as Harrow reveals that his name is Arthur. A woman presents herself to Arthur, and Stephen watches as his scale tattoo tips to one side and turns red. Arthur apologizes to the woman as she receives Ammit's judgment and falls back, and people carry away her lifeless body. The armed guards who were chasing Stephen come to Arthur's side and tell him they were ambushed during the exchange and 2 of their men were killed. To weed out the spy, Arthur calls out an order in ancient Egyptian, and Stephen is immediately found out. Arthur identifies Stephen as a mercenary. Stephen identifies himself to the crowd as Stephen Grant of the British Museum's gift shop. Arthur demands he return the scarab. The voice tells Stephen, "You will give him nothing." Not realizing what he is doing, Stephen continues to keep the scarab away from Arthur. As the people crowd Stephen and pry the scarab from his fingers, he blacks out and comes to when he hears the voice saying, "Oh no, the idiot's back." Stephen is now standing in the same spot with blood on his hand, and five townspeople laying unconscious around him, maybe dead. And he holds the scarab. As he escapes in an American van with the driver's side on the left, the voice commands him not to drop the scarab. While listening to Wham on the radio, Stephen is chased by several cars, all with non-British driver seats. As the action intensifies, Stephen again blacks out. And when he comes to, the windshield is shattered, an assailant dead, and Stephen holding his pistol. The voice now threatens Stephen to not lose the scarab. Stephen doesn't have time to get clarification, as he barely misses a truck carrying logs. The truck final destinations the remaining cars in pursuit with its logs, except for two. Stephen freaks out, blacks out again, and comes to as the last Jeep pulls in front of him, while a car falls off the roadway. The voice scolds him for losing the gun as two guards approach the van which has stalled. As he begins to panic again, the logs from the truck land at the lower roadway of the hill, taking out the guards, and violently waking Stephen up safely in his flat once again. Stephen finds himself restrained to his bedpost and feels relief. As he goes about his morning routine, he feeds Gus and notices that his fin has grown back. At the pet show, the associate is completely weirded out by Stephen's bizarre behavior. He cannot recall visiting the pet store the day before. But when he sees that the time is shortly after 5 p.m., he remembers that he is supposed to have a date. At home, Stephen dresses himself up and goes to the restaurant to meet his date. When she doesn't show, Stephen calls and reminds her that they were on for 7 p.m. Friday. She tells Stephen that today is Sunday and to lose her number. Completely confused and heartbroken, Stephen gives in and placing an order, knowing nothing of how to order steak. On his mom's voicemail, Stephen makes up a story about the date as he walks home. He turns the light in his apartment on and off before indulging in the box of chocolates he had bought for his date. He drops some sprinkles into the goldfish's tank. As he picks up some of the chocolates he dropped, he begins to notice strange things in his apartment and investigates behind a loose board above his pantry. He discovers a car key and a cell phone containing several missed calls from Layla and one missed call from Dushan. He calls Layla and is greeted with great surprise that he is still alive after so many months, and she demands to know where his British accent came from, and identifies Stephen by his true name, Mark. When Stephen inquires as to why she called him that, the call drops. Stephen hears his name being called and tries to see who it is. After hearing the voice tell him, "You need to stop," the lights begin to flicker, and Stephen runs scared from his flat to the elevator. Stephen looks at his reflection as the elevator continues its descent. On floor 2, Stephen hallucinates a creature coming for him, and when he comes face to face with its beak, he wakes up on a bus. Everyone on the bus is looking at Stephen as he sees the figure standing on the side of the road, then notices Arthur on the bus as he exits, realizing that he is real. As he enters the museum, he tries to get JB, the security guard from before, to help him, but is interrupted by Donna. Stephen sees Arthur in the museum and excuses himself from Donna. He follows a man he saw on the bus and is confronted by Arthur walking on his cane. As he asks another security guard to help, the guard reveals his scale tattoo and proclaims, "Praise Amit." Arthur explains the philosophy of Amit to him. She grew tired of waiting for sinners to commit their sins before punishing them. He tells Stephen that Amit judges our entire lives, including our futures, which we cannot see. Stephen quips that the historical documents have forgotten that part. Arthur believes that Amit was betrayed and imprisoned by indolent fellow gods. Had she been free, she may have prevented the fall of the Holy Roman Empire and the Holocaust, among other genocidal tragedies. Arthur tells Stephen that Amit was betrayed by her own avatar, a term which Stephen only knows from popular culture. Arthur knows about the voice in Stephen's head and sets him up to be judged by Amit. As the cane dangles, the scale on Stephen's arms, Arthur's scale tattoo shakes uncontrollably, signifying chaos within Stephen. The doors to another exhibit open and Stephen runs away from Arthur, who tells the guards to let him go. Stephen is doing inventory by himself as the museum closes. As he is leaving, hears a dog crying in the distance and follows the sound. Stephen is being followed as well. As he hides from an unseen creature, Arthur announces through the museum that Stephen must return the scarab. Stephen runs into the men's bathroom to hide, and is engaged in a mirror by his true alter ego Mark Spector. Mark explains to Stephen that he needs to fully give him control if they want to survive this attack. Stephen agrees and allows Mark to take him over as the creature breaks in and assaults him. The creature is then seen trying to escape, but is pulled back in and beaten to its presumed final death by a light gray clad hero with a face covering cowl, a hood, and a cape. His name is Moon Knight. Stephen wakes up and hearing the jackal, the creature we saw before. He chained to his bed again, asks Mark in the mirror if he is there, but Mark didn't reply. He heads back to work to make sure that Knight was real, but at the museum they're fixing the destruction that was caused by the jackal. Stephen asks the security guard what happened, and he tells Stephen they're saying burst pipes. He asks if anyone saw the tape, and the guy says he is about to do that now. They sit in the camera's room, and Stephen tells him they maybe see strange things, like Area 51. Surprisingly, Stephen watches himself sobbing in a corner before running away from something invisible. But they find nothing else except Stephen. They see the footage when Stephen come out, and the guard says it is still you. It's clear now that Arthur has the power to summon up horrors that only exist in his plane of reality. Stephen says that's not me, and finds Mark looking at him through the camera. Unfortunately, the museum knows who destroyed the bathroom. They bring him in to let him know that he's being fired and referred to a psychologist. And they're not going to press charges, they just want him to leave. Before he leaves, the security guard asks if he has any museum property on him. And Stephen doesn't at least know what he has, are the cell phone and the storage locker key. Stephen goes to the gold-painted man again and tells him what happened. He swears that he found things hidden in his flat. And although the man didn't say anything, Stephen thinks that he should explore the things he found. And if he could find that storage locker, that might be his one chance to prove to himself that he is not mad. Stephen thanks the man and leaves. He finds the place and goes there, says he is looking for his storage locker. It is under Stephen Grant or Mark. The security recognizes Stephen and leads him to a storage locker that Stephen's never been before. No. This unit is set up as if someone was living there. It's got a cot and food, also a bag full of money with fake passports. And a passport has Stephen's photo, but it says Mark Spector. He also finds inside the scarab. It opens up like a drone. Stephen thinks it's a compass, but he doesn't know what it's pointing to. And that's when he hears Mark from behind him. Mark apologized to Stephen, telling him that he wasn't supposed to see any of this. And he goes on to explain how Stephen is in danger. He can save him just like he did the previous night, but what he can't have him do is meddle. And Stephen does not take this news well. He yells at Mark, "Tell me what you are." Mark tells him that he serves the god of the moon, a god named Khonshu. And Mark Spector is Khonshu's avatar, which means that in a way Stephen is also Khonshu's avatar. Their job is to protect the vulnerable and deliver Khonshu's justice to those that hurt them. Mark made a deal with Khonshu, and that deal is contingent on Stephen not meddling. So he tells Stephen, "I need the body, and once it's done, you're never going to see me again." Stephen doesn't really like that deal, has his own plan. He's going to take all that illegal stuff in the bag and go to the police. And he's completely okay with the scenario that the police lock him up and throw him in an insane asylum. He hopes that maybe they chalk him up with enough pills so Mark will be out of his head forever. When he leaves the storage facility, Khonshu is in the hallway waiting for him. He tries to outrun Khonshu, but he's unable to, and he turns a corner right into Khonshu, who tells him, "Give it back, you fool." Stephen doesn't follow that advice and runs out in the street, where he's narrowly hit by a woman on a moped. But that woman recognizes him. She calls him Mark, and Stephen figures that she must be Layla. And in fact she is. He begs her to give him a ride back to his apartment, even though she thinks she's talking to Mark. We find out that Layla and Mark are married, and when they arrive at Stephen's apartment, they find out that they have a lot in common. He knows all about Egyptian history, and she is Egyptian, she also knows French as he. But even though they seem to be hitting it off, scolds him and tells him that he knows these things. She came there for a purpose. It's because Mark had sent her divorce papers, but they were unsigned. So she had to track him down, shows up and get them signed. And Stephen is floored. He can't believe anybody would dump her. As Stephen is insulting Mark for being an idiot, Mark is listening and pleading with Stephen to leave her alone the whole time. Stephen is ignoring him, but just before Stephen is about to show her what's in the bag, Mark yells, "You're will get her killed." And that's enough for Stephen to stop. Although it's not enough to kill Layla's curiosity, she starts looking through the bag and quickly finds the scarab. And that's when she gets really pissed off. She knows exactly what the scarab is. It's the scarab pointing to Amit's tomb. And this was something that she and Mark fought side by side to get. Now she thinks that Mark is divorcing her, so he can keep it for himself. This causes Stephen to say, "Go ahead, take it, I don't want it." And he tries to once again explain that he is not Mark, he's Stephen Grant. But the conversation gets interrupted when two police officers knock on the door. They barge their way in and start looking around, but they don't find Layla, she's gone. What they do find is that bag full of money and the fake passport. And that's enough to take Stephen in. When they run the name Mark Spector, what they find is shocking. Because Mark Spector is an international fugitive. He was a part of a team of mercenaries that hit a dig site in Egypt. They zip-tied all of the archaeologists and shot them. This is really surprising to the cops. But it turns out they're not cops, because they don't take him to a police precinct. They're in fact working with Harrow. Stephen knows that he's in a tough predicament, and he's visited by Mark in a reflection. And says, "Just give me your body, I'll take care of these people." But Stephen doesn't want to do it, because he saw what Mark did in that small village. And Stephen doesn't want to kill. Harrow shows up and uncuffs him. They start walking through this small part of town, and Harrow tells him that it used to be the worst part of town. But after Amit's judgment, it's now so safe that people leave their doors unlocked. As they're discussing this, Stephen sees Khonshu. And by his reaction, Harrow knows that Stephen is looking at Khonshu. So he tells Stephen, "He can't hurt, you don't worry about it," and it does put Stephen's mind at ease. As Stephen and Harrow make their way into a building that we saw before, Khonshu is throwing a temper tantrum. And everything that Khonshu is telling Stephen, Harrow's already heard. Because Harrow used to be Khonshu's avatar, that is until he escaped. Harrow explains that Khonshu's justice comes too late by the time. It shows up people have already suffered, Amit knows this. That's why she casts her judgment before evil is done. And that is why their entire mission is to resurrect Amit. And this could create a better world. But they can't do it without the scarab. Stephen tells him, "I don't have it," and Harrow doesn't believe him. Stephen though has some questions about Amit's judgment. Like, are you gonna kill a child just because of something that might happen 30 years down the line? Or what about the people that think about killing their boss, but they're never actually going to act on it? Harrow compares it to cutting off a limb to save the body. And that doesn't sit well with Stephen, because as he points out, a child isn't a limb. Harrow then shows Stephen his cane. It was Amit's gift to her first avatar, and it contains a sliver of her power. The cane then starts glowing purple. Harrow says to Stephen, "I don't want to use it, but you gotta give me the scarab." And Mark, knowing what could happen, warning Stephen the entire time, "Don't give up Layla's name, give me the body." But Stephen is gonna have to give up her name, because Layla does that all on her own. She jumps out of the corner and says, "I have a scarab," as she makes her way forward to Harrow. Stephen can hear Khonshu tell Mark, "There's no deal in this, you better fix this." But right before she hands it over to Harrow, she turns to Stephen and says, "Summon the suit." And that means nothing to Stephen. He has no idea what she's talking about. She then gives him the scarab and starts to run away. And as they're trying to get out of there, we find out that Layla is a complete and total badass. Harrow knows that he can't let the scarab get out of his possession. So he uses that cane, the power of a portal opens up, and a jackal comes out. Stephen and Layla barricade themselves in a room. But the jackal is standing outside, ready to bust itself in. She starts explaining to Stephen that his real name is Mark, and there is a suit that he uses. She's literally seen him use it all this time. Mark is begging Stephen to just let him use the body. But that's when the jackal busts through the door and tackles Stephen through a window. That's when Stephen yells, and it works, kind of the summons a suit. But it doesn't look anything like Mark's suit. Mark starts making fun of him, telling him that he's supposed to conjure the ceremonial armor from Khonshu's temple, not Psycho Colonel Sanders. But they don't really have time to talk. Stephen starts getting attacked by that jackal, although Stephen's the only one that can see it. Layla Ken in fact thinks he's being possessed, until she throws some water on it, and sees that there is a monster attacking him. Stephen knocks the jackal out, but as he's celebrating it, the jackal pops up and starts beating him up again. At this point, Stephen gave it his all and it's not enough. He needs to let Mark have the body. And Mark fares a lot better than Stephen when it comes to killing a jackal, so he finishes it. As soon as he transforms back from the Moon Knight to Mark Spector, he starts looking for the scarab, but he can't find it. And that's because the scarab fell out of Stephen's possession when he fell out of the window. It gets picked up by a homeless man, and that homeless man is found by Harrow, who kills him and takes it. That's one problem that Mark has. The other problem that he has is Stephen wants to retake the body, but Stephen doesn't have enough power to do that. And now he's got Stephen yelling at him, telling him that he has no right to take the body. But Mark needs to finish the deal that he made with Khonshu. What really annoys Stephen is the fact that he finally realizes all the things wrong in his life. The fact that he sleepwalks, the fact that he can't go on a date, and the fact that he has to chain himself up at night. And is all because of Mark Spector. Mark promises him that once he's done and repaid the debt, Stephen will never see him again. They then somehow get into an argument about Mark's relationship with Layla. And Mark explains to Stephen that Khonshu was planning on making her Mark's replacement. He couldn't let that happen, so he divorced her. But this is the final straw for Mark. He gets so sick of listening to Stephen that he bashes the glass to destroy the reflection. He's then visited by Khonshu, who reminds him that he was nothing more than a corpse when Khonshu found him. And the fact that Mark thinks he owns that body is laughable. Mark swears to him that they'll find the scarab, but Khonshu tells him it's too late. Harrow has it, and that means Mark has to get to Amit's tomb first. But there's only one way to do that. They have to go to Egypt. Habibi, Baba, Adarna, Kena, Asaba, Ishna, Basata. The third episode opens with Layla. She also wants to go to Cairo, and even though she's Egyptian, she needs a fake passport. So she goes to someone that's not only familiar with, but also familiar with her father. Tells her, if she is not worried about might have burned too many bridges, and all those stolen relics and cheeky antiques. Layla justifies that she doesn't steal, they have already been stolen, and that's what people forget. She takes them off the black market and returns them to their rightful owners. We find out that Layla's father was an archaeologist. He, like her, was also after the scarab. But as she goes off to meet Mark in Cairo, Harrow's already arrived with the scarab, directing him to Amit's tomb. Speaks Arabic, we found Amit, she is here. He's so excited, doesn't even care. When he gets that Mark Spector is in Cairo, and doesn't mean he is will not take preemptive measures. Mark gets a lead on where the dig site might be. He goes to meet the guy. Unfortunately, the guy just got stabbed by a bunch of Arthur's men. One of the men tells him, too late, and you never will find Harrow. He made something strange with his knife. So Mark says, are we dancing or we fighting? And they start attacking Mark. But Mark can handle his own. When it comes time for Mark to actually kill these guys, Stephen shows up in a reflection, begging him not to kill them. All of a sudden, Mark blacks out. When he wakes up, he finds himself in the back of a taxi cab, having no idea how he got there, or where he's headed turns out. Speaks Arabic to make the driver stop, and says, where are you taking me? The taxi driver tells him, you are said airport. He then suddenly sees the guys who attacked him walking out of a building. Mark needs answers, and they want him to let them go after what he did. He chases after them in the street, and eventually, he catches up to one of them. Mark starts punching the guy, demanding to know where is Harrow, but he sees his reflection. It's Stephen again, begging him to stop, and this distracts Mark long enough for him to get knocked out. Mark blacks out once again. He wakes up on the top of a building with most of the guys dead. Has no idea how they got to that point. He says, Stephen, what did you do? Stephen swears that was not him. Mark then says, who was it? They found one of Arthur's men left alive, Khonshu starts pressuring Mark to get answers from him, taking him over to the ledge and threatening to throw him off. But Mark doesn't want to do it, saying he's just a kid. Khonshu pressures him though, saying if he does that, the kid will talk. So Mark gives in, escorting the kid over to the ledge and demanding to know where the dig site, but the kid doesn't talk, deciding he'd rather kill himself than give up the location. And because of this, they now need a new plan. Mark asks Khonshu what about the other gods, which means are they just will stand by and allow somebody to unleash Amit, asking Khonshu to summon a meeting. But Khonshu is hesitant to ask for an audience with the gods. The last time he did that, he was imprisoned in stone. After thinking about it, Khonshu realizes this is the best option. So he sends the gods a message that even they can't ignore. He changes the sky through his ability. This includes Harold, who knows he is about to be called upon. He says that Khonshu getting desperate, old bird, tells the workers to keep digging. They all show up, or at least their avatars do. Convene inside the Great Pyramid with surprising Steven and can't believe it. The first avatar that Mark meets is Yatsiel. She is the avatar of Hathor, goddess of music and love. She asks him if Khonshu told him how this works. Mark tells, not really. And she explains, it's a strange sensation, but do not fight it. You will get used to it. Yatsiel and Khonshu used to be pretty close. She though gets called away by the other gods who want to speed this and start the meeting. In attendance, Horus, Isis, Tefnu, Osiris, and Hathor, to hear the account of Khonshu. Unfortunately for Khonshu, Osiris, who seems to be leading the meeting, does not really like him, says to him, you have been banished once for nearly exposing us. And they despise his garishness, his showy masks and weapons. Warns him, if he manipulates the sky again, he will imprison in stone. Khonshu starts explaining to the gods, he was banished for not abandoning humanity, unlike the rest of them. Osiris says, we simply trust our avatars to carry out our purposes without calling undue attention to ourselves. Khonshu says avatars are not enough, we need the might of gods. Return from the opulence of the overvoid before we lose this realm. But Osiris explains, the avatars that remain here are simply meant to observe. We decided long ago to did not wish to meddle in the affairs of man, and they will decide our best course of action. Asks him to speak his purpose. Khonshu says I call for judgment against Arthur Harrow. And when they ask about the charges, Khonshu says that is a conspiracy to release Amit, which is a heavy accusation. So they summon the accused. But in turn, Harrow makes the case that Khonshu isn't doing so well. Khonshu asks Arthur in front of everybody, do you not want to raise Amit from the tomb? Arthur says that he was in the desert. But if visiting the sands were a crime, the line of sinners would be longer than the Nile. Continue that Khonshu searched for Amit's tomb, since Khonshu ensnared him to his service. With his vision that is obscured by jealousy and paranoia, Khonshu interrupts his speech, saying he's a deceiver. But Harrow is continues by saying, do not trust the word of a shamed god. Khonshu is unhinged and his servant is unwell, and they ask how do you mean? Harrow tells them this is a man who literally does not know his own name and has a marriage certificate under the name Mark Spector and employment records under the name Stephen Grant. Harrow has seen him speak and threaten himself, and he has no idea how many personalities Mark must possess, explaining that Mark is clearly insane, and when Khonshu starts to attack him, forced to stop, because they do not tolerate violence in this chamber. Harrow then says that Khonshu is taking advantage of Mark, the same way that he abused him, and the way he aspires to abuse this court. Harrow demands to take action now before it's too late, and they let Mark Spector speak, asking him, is he unwell? Breathing heavily, it's Steven. He says, I'm unwell, and I need help. But that doesn't change the fact that this man is. They remind him, that is a safe space for him to tell them if he feels exploited by Khonshu. Steven says is not about my feelings, I'm not the one on trial here, he has committed no offense. This speech by Harrow works and this matter is concluded. The gods side with him and don't really think he is a threat. After the meeting, Yatsiel pulls Mark aside and explains there might be another way to find out where the tomb is. Says Amit was buried in secret and the location was hidden even from the gods. But there was one person who knew where the tomb was. Just in case they had to bring Amit back. The person who knew was a Medjay named Senful. He was tasked with recording the location of the tomb, in case the gods ever changed their minds and decided to show mercy, telling him if you find Senfu, you will find the tomb. The issue is Senfu's sarcophagus was stolen, and no one has any idea where it is. But if he is able to locate the sarcophagus, he should be able to locate the tomb. Mark has to go to the black market, looking for the sarcophagus and asking around. But he is not getting anywhere. And that's when he runs into Layla. She points out to him, "You are not getting anywhere with this, because you're not Egyptian. So nobody trusts you, and you don't know where to look." Layla starts poking around, and it doesn't take long for her to find out who has a sarcophagus. But she points out to Mark, "I'm not here to help you. I'm here to help me and everybody else who would die if Hero succeeds." The two head over to inspect the sarcophagus in a boat. As they're on the trip, she tells Mark, "You could have told me about Steven." And he explains to her that until recently, Steven was under control. She asks what changed, and he just tells her it doesn't matter. And Mark asks her, "How do you know this guy?" She says they know each other from their run-ins in Madrid. The two seem to have a good relationship, and they are old friends. Just to be on the safe side, Mark's stash is a book bag full of supplies that could possibly help him out under one of the docks. And he notices that they were being followed. He's not quite sure if it's Harrow's men, but he's pretty confident. They then arrive at a guy named Anton Mogart. Mogart owns the sarcophagus. He's very rich and has a lot of friends with a lot of guns. He doesn't mind showing them the sarcophagus, but he is worried about their motives. However, he lets him in and keeps an eye on them. They start looking around the sarcophagus, but there's no real clue about the place of the tomb. At this moment, they know that they need Steven. Mark doesn't want to do it, but even he knows he needs him. So Layla heads out to distract the men as Mark continues to talk to Steven, trying to get some hint on what they can do to find out where the tomb. Steven quickly notices that there are pieces of cloth in the sarcophagus, and if we fold them, it should lead to a map where it would be located. Mark starts doing that, but he gets caught by Mogart's head of security. Just instinctually, Mark disarms him with his own gun, but he quickly has two other security guards with guns pointed at him. It causes Mark to stand down. Mogart is pissed, and Layla begs him for mercy, saying they were just trying to save lives. But Harrow shows up and tells Mogart, "I could probably offer you something much more tangible than whatever they're offering you." And he pulls out the scarab. Harrow then turns his attention to both Layla and Mark by telling them, "You two have much more in common than you know." Like Layla, she keeps thinking that distance will prevent the wounds from her father's death. But something stands in her way. It's the fact that her husband doesn't tell the truth. Because he know if he do, she will see him exactly as he see himself. He then turns his attention back to Mogart, asking him, "Do you want to see real power?" And all the while Khonshu is standing behind them, begging Mark to summon the suit. As Mark is sitting there, watching Harrow give a show on the power he has, Mark does finally summon the suit and starts taking all of Mogart's men out. While Layla is tasked with grabbing the pieces of cloth, Mark fights them one by one. Steven orders Mark to stop and give him the body. He blacks out, and Steven is there. He says, "I'm sorry, time out guys, let's all calm down and talk for a second." But he's stabbed by a man behind him, and Steven yells, "Quickly take the body, Mark," and blacks out again. Mark is here, and Layla attacks the man. He is stabbed by more than one person, with badly injured. Layla uses her weapon and manages to kill the man death. She takes a gun and goes out to help Mark. Mark shouts Layla when he finds Mogart attacking her. He kills them all. Runs to save Layla before Mogart kills her, and he finishes him. Khonshu shows up and says, "Tick-tock, Mark." Once they get down the road, and it seems like they're safe, Layla asks him what was Harrow talking about, that whole time he is not telling the truth. Sure, Mark knows exactly what Harrow was talking about, but he deflects by saying that Harrow was just trying to mess with you. What freaks out Layla is the fact that she never told anyone why she really moved. We can tell though that there are definitely trust issues between the two. They then head to the middle of the desert, and they start putting the pieces of cloth together that form constellations. The problem is, they are having trouble doing it. Mark doesn't want to admit it, but he knows he needs Steven's help. So he tags Steven in, and Steven thanks him for letting him help. He is quickly able to put it together, figuring out exactly the constellations and the stars. But there is one giant issue. When that map was put together, the sky was slightly different than it is now. Stars move over time, so if they follow the map that they have, they're not going to get to the tomb. They need to know what the sky looked like back when the map was made. And since it was hundreds of years ago, there is nobody around that actually knows that. But then, Khonshu speaks up, because he remembers that night. Even though he knows, that's will get him in trouble with the other gods. And he along with Steven, turn the clock back, changing the sky from today to what it used to be. And this does result in Khonshu getting locked up in stone. Before he is locked up, he says to Steven, tell Mark to free me. And this gives both Steven and Layla a pinpoint location of where the tomb. Arthur says, you brought this upon yourself, Khonshu. Khonshu's stone is taken to the Great Pyramid, where the Avatar who to be in charge. Harrow is told that he was right about Khonshu. Now he is tethered to this place, like many before him. Harrow doesn't know if Khonshu can hear him, but he decides to speak to him anyway, telling him that he's going to do what he couldn't. And when it's finished, he wants Khonshu to remember one thing, that Khonshu's torment forced Harrow to do it, and that he owes his victory to Khonshu. Khonshu's stone is imprisoned inside a wall in which there are other statues. That's not really clear. But surely they were imprisoned for reasons as Khonshu. What happened to the sky by Steven and Khonshu put a strain on Steven and he was knocked out. Layla tries to revive him. And as she's doing that, a few of Harrow's men show up to get rid of them. But she is able to dispose of them by shoving a flare into their car. Steven wakes up and they head off to the tomb. Layla mentions that they are going to need Mark now. Steven refuses because he and Mark made a deal that when Mark was done with Khonshu, Mark would disappear for good. Layla is surprised because they made a deal without telling her anything. She asks Steven, so he was just going to leave her life. And Mark didn't think if she must be made aware of that. Steven points out that Mark has already done disappeared from her life, and she agrees with him. Mark is arguing with Steven because he thinks it is a suicide mission. And without Khonshu, there's no more suit, no more healing, and no more power. Plus Mark is better equipped to fight Harrow's men. So he wants to take the body from Steven in this part, but Steven doesn't say anything. At the dig site, they notice that is nobody is there, and they start poking around it and trying to find any supplies they might need. Mark begs Steven one last time to let him take over the body, but Steven refuses again. He tries to tell Steven that's for Layla, but Steven still refuses. And he points out if Steven is in love with his wife, but Steven walks away without letting Mark finish the sentence. The fact is Steven is in love with her and thinks she's perfect. Steven then tells her why Mark filed for divorce, and he thinks she should know that Khonshu was planning on taking her as his avatar if he died. Layla says that she doesn't need protection, she just needs honesty. It seems that she also loves Steven. At that moment, they both finally head into the tomb. And when they do, they are surprised by what they see. Steven is a giant Egypt nerd. He starts finding out the fact that there are some of the first people to step foot into this tomb. Layla draws something in Arabic on the stone, and she says it's for her father. She tells him about her father, the archaeologist, who was on a mission and would have loved to be here. And to her father, it was a dream worth dying, trying to find it. Steven says that her father will be positively beaming now, seeing her standing in the proof of it. They start heading deeper into the tomb, and what they are looking for is Amit's prison of stone, Ashabti. It's basically the same thing that Khonshu was put in. In the room, Layla notices that there are empty bullet casings, and she wondering what would they be shooting at. They find out that is a maze, and there are six paths, also that's whole structure is a symbol of the Eye of Horus. It is the royal symbol, and her final avatar was a pharaoh. Steven points out that the Eye of Horus is also the Eye of the Mind, representing the six senses, 6 points. So they got the eyebrow, that denotes thoughts. The pupil is the sight. The others are hearing, smell, touch. And the long line ending in a spiral is the tongue. It's revealed that the avatar would be Amit voice, so they will find her in the tongue part. Now they have a map, and they have to find it. In the next room, it looks like there is an ancient Egyptian autopsy table in the middle. And what's concerning is the fact that the table has fresh blood on it. There is also blood all over the floor, leading to the entrance to another room, and they don't really want to follow that trail of blood, so they need to find another way in. And that's when Steven notices that there's an opening above them. He heads up there to look around, starts geeking out over all the things he's seeing. They then hear a gun go off and screams from the distance, and something starts dragging a body into that room. Steven hides, and he's safe already. But Layla is the one who truly is in danger. Approaches the table, an ancient Egyptian monster, or a jackal to protect the temple. The temple guard starts dissecting the body right near her, and they do not want to run into it. Unfortunately for Layla, as she's trying to avoid it, she ends up knocking into something, and alerting that somebody else is there. The guard then goes nearly to Steven's place. Steven screams, so the monster going to kill him. But Layla throws a bottle in the wall to distract the monster. Steven tells her to run, and he pushes down a bunch of items to crush it. Layla is able to escape, but the two end up splitting up. She is trying to find her way to Amit, and she walks on the edge of the rocks, but she is followed by another monster. She is pulled inside and fights with it until escapes with the guard's hand. The guard attacks her again, and she is able to hurt the guard by shoving a flare into its eye and throwing it into a pit of despair. All of this is seen by Harrow, who is on the other side of the pit. Harrow can't get to her because there is no bridge, so there is no threat. He starts talking to her, but she doesn't want to listen to him, until he brings up her father by saying "my little scarab," that is what her father called her, and that ropes her back into this conversation. Harrow says that her father would be so proud of her if he knew that his daughter was among the first to confirm for the world what he always believed, and that the Egyptian gods walk among us. He points out that the scales achieve their judgment by revealing to him moments of sin and pain, and her husband is in agony, more pain than anyone could bear, cause Mark still hasn't told her the truth, which Harrow read his scales, and the scales do not lie. Harrow starts putting the pieces down, and Layla is able to put the puzzle together. That the thing Mark wasn't telling her was that he was the mercenary at the dig site the day her father was murdered. She feels betrayed and hurt that Mark was the one who did it, but she doesn't want to show Harrow that, so she leaves. She goes deeper into the tomb, where hopefully we'll be able to confront Mark about this. Harrow then gets word from his men that they found another way. Steven had found his way into the tomb. As he is geeking out, he is visited by Mark in a reflection, where Mark confronts him about the fact that Steven kissed his wife. Also the fact that everything Steven said was accurate about why he's been pushing her away. And that was unexpected from Steven. Steven then starts reading the hieroglyphics on the tomb. It figures out the sarcophagus that they are looking at must be holding Alexander the Great. And Alexander the Great must have been Amit's avatar. Steven also knows that the Egyptians would have hidden Amit's Ashapi somewhere that wasn't easy to find, since Alexander the Great was the avatar, and he spoke for her. Steven thinks that there is a chance the Ashapti might be in the mouth, so he then rips open the bandages and breaking the jaw. Eventually, he finds it. When Layla walks in, she finds Steven celebrating the fact that he was able to locate it, but she is in no mood to celebrate. She demands to talk to Mark, and she needs to get answers to what Harold told her. So Steven tags Mark in. The story that Mark has is he didn't kill her father, but he was one of the mercenaries. Mark says that his partner got greed, and he executed everyone at the dig site. He tried to save her father, but he couldn't save him. She says that he brought a killer right to him, and he says yes. Mark also explained that his boss also shoots him, leaving him for dead where Khonshu found and saved him. When Mark was all better, he went to go find Layla and tell her what happened. But he couldn't bring himself to do this. And what upsets Layla the most is the fact that the only reason they got married was Mark felt guilty about what he did to her father. But they don't have time to discuss it anymore, because they hear Harrow's men coming. Layla goes to look for an exit, and Mark tasks himself with holding Harrow's men off. Harrow walks in and sees that Mark has the Ashapti. He tells him that he needs to hand it over, and it looks like for a second Mark is going to, and that's when he just starts killing all of Harrow's men. Harrow is done dealing with Mark's crap, so he pulls out a gun and shoots him twice without the protection of Khonshu, and he says that he can't save anyone who won't save themselves, sending him falling into a pool of water that quickly fades into darkness the further Mark drifts away. then cuts to an Indiana Jones-like film, starring a character named Dr. Stephen Grant instead of Indiana Jones, which is revealed to be playing on a television in a psychiatric hospital. It's revealed that everything in the insane asylum Stephen interacted with before the bingo caller is the gold-painted man and holding a hat, which is the same that Stephen made sure people were throwing tips into for him. And the patient who is trying to solve a Rubik's cube is the same cube we saw Stephen solving while trying to stay awake. The orderly who is handing the food to patients, the same person we saw as one of Harrow's followers posing as an agent and arresting Stephen. And we see Donna, who was previously Stephen's boss at the museum. She holding a toy that seems to be a scarab and hoping that the bingo caller calls some O's. Also, the clock that is seen behind Donna appears to use Conchu's staff as one of the hands on the clock. The orderly who is pushing around a cart with cupcakes is the man who we met when Mark and Layla were going to meet Mogart. And Beck's cupcake card connects to Stephen and Mark's hilarious chase with Harrow's men while in a cupcake van. Additionally, one of the patients is sketching a bird who appears to have the same head as Conchu. We can spot a goldfish in a bowl, which matches up to Stephen's one fin wonder fish Gus. And the orderly who talks to Mark about sitting in his favorite spot, the same person we saw as one of Harrow's followers, posing as an agent alongside the woman. Layla is putting up postcards, just like the one Stephen had in his apartment. We can see that she's eating, like she did when she was getting her fake passport. And she says, "I won." Mark is stunned and calls Stephen in the mirror but gets nothing. When he falls out of his wheelchair, he is clutching a Moon Knight action figure, and his leg is tied to the chair, like Stephen tying himself to his bed. When he goes to talk to the therapist, surprisingly the therapist is Arthur Harrow. Harrow tries to explain that Mark had a mental break, and that his obsession with the fictional film entitled Tomb Buster led him to struggle to differentiate between what is real and fiction. The painting that Mark spots matched the place where Stephen woke up before meeting Harrow and his followers for the first time. Harrow explains that the film makes a meal out of a plot about a lunar god with an eccentric villain and an explorer of sorts at its helm. Mark also notices Harrow's cane and slippers, which we saw Harrow was using and wearing. Everything seems to be pointing to the fact that Mark made up all of this in his mind, and he's simply crazy. But the point is, Mark doesn't believe, clearly remembers Harrow shooting him. He has no plans of staying there any longer than he has to, so Mark tries to escape. When he runs, we finds that the lamps moves like Harrow's scale. As he's doing so, he is chased, but he manages to sneak into a side room. And he finds, in that room, is a sarcophagus. Somebody inside, and screaming for someone to let him out. And Mark does that, only to find that the person he let out is Stephen Grant. Now instead of the two sharing a body, they are staring at each other. Both men are relieved to see each other. And they also can't figure out how this is even possible. They just need to figure out a way out. They also find another sarcophagus, somebody inside, that is screaming hard for someone to let him out, but they don't really care. The two run out of the room, but they find, like an Egyptian hippo god, waving at them. The episode starts off in a cave with a boy yelling help, then shows a woman who says this is all your fault. And we pick up right where the last episode, with Hippo being introduced and Mark and Stephen freaking out. However, instead of addressing who this Hippo, we actually cut back to the office of Harrow. It seems that Mark has a busted nose, and he did not have this where he is talking to Harrow in the office. Harrow explains that he didn't shoot him, and says that Mark's mind is violently vacillating between sense and nonsense. His brain is a pendulum, swinging between a very difficult reality and a reassuring fantasy that Mark has created on his own. Also, he is his patient here at Putnam Medical Facility in Chicago, Illinois. Mark says, "You're not really a doctor." But Harrow explains, "It's not about me." Asks Mark to try it his way and retrace his steps. Harrow says that Mark told him he was in a place that was oddly reminiscent of Harrow's office, except that it wasn't here and he was with a rhinoceros. But Mark corrects him, "It's a hippo. An animal, but it talked." So Harrow asks, do you think that is sense or nonsense? Mark agrees, which Harrow finds really encouraging. Harrow continues, that the struggling mind will often build places to seek shelter for different aspects of the self from our most traumatic memories. It's called just an organizing principle. Some people see a castle, somebody else will see a maze or a library. Mark cuts him, or a psych ward, and Harrow says yes. What Harrow finds extremely interesting is the new animal character that he saw. Explains this hippo could break down the walls between him and Steven, and they might finally understand. When Harrow asks about the boy that he was talking about, Mark's demeanor seems to be a little bit different, until he leans forward and says, "Thank you, I feel really great." He then grabs the crystal pyramid, like he's about to use it as a weapon. So the doctor hits the emergency button, that signals the guards to come in. When the guards grab him, he starts yelling, "You are gonna release that monster, you're not a doctor." It seems that this is not the actual voice of Mark or Steven. It's revealed he is a completely different person. He also doesn't have the same demeanor as Mark or Steven. This is most likely another personality. As previous, when Mark takes control of the body and finds a knife that he's holding is stabbed into a person, he looks around and says, "Steven, what did you do?" Which Steven says, "I didn't do that," and Mark says, "I didn't." And also the other sarcophagus that is screaming hard, all confirming a third personality inside of the body. But when Mark is injected, he yells. Then we go back to the hippo, and she confirms that they are in the Duat, the Egyptian underworld, and that hippo is indeed the goddess Tauret, the goddess of women and children, also the goddess who helps guide souls through the afterlife. Steven, being the somewhat scholar that he is, automatically knows who she is and realizes what is happening, but is actually in shock. Something that is interesting here is that Tauret says that this is an afterlife, not the afterlife. She confirms that there are actually different realms of it, so not all people go to the same realm when they die. And she actually mentions the ancestral plains, and she says, "Just gorgeous. We can remember the Egyptian goddess is a part of the Ennead, and we saw a statue of her at Khonshu's meeting." She says you'd be surprised how many intersectional planes of untethered consciousness exist. What this basically means, based on the mind of the person that has died, so whatever afterlife you go to is pretty much based on your mind. And for the sake of Mark and Steven, it's an asylum. Tauret explains you may perceive the afterlife as something more easily recognizable to yourself. So to Mark and Steven, it's an asylum, because as Mark says, they're insane. Mark says Dr. Harrow's right, and this is an organizing principle. Steven is surprised that Harrow is a doctor, although they really aren't insane. Mark opens a door which leads to the afterlife, and Tauret's boat is taking them to essentially judgment. Steven says, "We're sailing to Aru, to the Field of Reeds, and the Field of Reeds is essentially heaven." But Tauret says that they kind of have to be judged first. Their hearts have to be weighed, so she takes their hearts and puts them on the scale of justice. The statue in the middle is of Anubis, the god of the dead. The Egyptians believed that the heart was the sign of who you really were in life, and if the scales balance by the time you end the journey, then a soul is permitted to pass into the Field of Reeds. Mark asks, "And what if they don't balance?" She says, "You will get thrown overboard. The dead will drag you down into the Duat, where you will remain forever, frozen in the sand, which no unbalanced souls on her boat." Mark doesn't care about her talks. He says to Steven, "There is no way they are will end up down there." He suggests killing the hippo and stealing the boat. Tauret says there is a problem, the scales aren't balancing. She continues that the reason, because their hearts aren't full, they are hiding something from each other. Without balanced scales, the Duat will eventually claim their soul, and their soul will be destroyed. She explains the boat contains all of their life's memories, so they need to go inside and work it out, no more secrets. Steven asks if Layla is all right. Mark says yeah for now, and knowing her, she will go on a suicide mission to stop Harrow herself. It seems that Mark's memories are a freaking mess, and we see some old memories of Mark and Steven. Steven sees a street and asks if Mark remembers this. But he says, it's just a street. Then they go into a room, where we discover a few things. We see the dead people that Mark killed when he was a mercenary. Steven asks him if he remembers all of them. Mark says they were criminals, murderers, and predators. The worst of the worst, and Khonshu wanted them punished. He kept wishing he would fail, and one of them would kill him instead. And that the healing ended up being a curse. They then see the scales are slowing down so it works. However, there's a little boy in the room, and Mark recognizes him. But Steven doesn't, and wonders why a child here. Mark tries to get Steven not to go after him. But Steven does, and enters a room. And locks Mark out of a room, which Mark begging him to open the door. He sees his family, also sees himself, and a brother drawing a one-fin fish. Obviously that Steven never knew of the brother. Mark and his brother Roro decide not to eat, and go play in a cave. His mother says be sure to look after your brother. He agrees, and says laters gators, is what we actually hear Steven say to his mom. Then she says in a wild crocodile. While walking, his brother says that he will be Rosser, and asks can you hear that Dr. Grant? Mark says, I sure do Rosser. It's like the fictional film entitled Tomb Buster, which we saw before. They enter the cave. Then it starts raining, which makes the cave pretty dangerous. And water starts coming up from the bottom. Steven calling boys, come on lads, we have to leave. During all of this, Mark is outside begs Steven to come back there. And we hear young Mark calling his brother, follow my voice. But Roro yells, I want my mom. Steven hears this, but it is just a memory. And sadly Mark's brother dies. We cut to his mother saying, that she want him back. When Mark comes down the stairs, his mother yells, and says what are you doing here? This is all your fault. He goes upstairs with Steven chasing after him. We see his father calling the mom to blow out the candles, but she is not coming. His father justifies, that his mother not feeling well, and they will do it together this year. But she pretty much makes his life a living hell. It was hard enough to deal with the death of her son. Steven sees another birthday, and his mom says, you were always jealous of him, and she should have known that Mark would do something like this. Steven wonders, mom, what are you doing? And he goes after him. When Steven is trying to open the door, Mark grabs him outside the home, and Steven asks what happened in that room. We cut to where Mark is running away from home. His dad asks him to stay, but he leaves anyways. Mark says that's enough, and grabs Steven into a desert. We see dead bodies, so Steven tells him that Harrow said, you were a mercenary, and that you killed hostages. Mark explains that he was in the military before, but got discharged because he went AWOL in a fugue state. AWOL means that you left without official leave, and he didn't have a ton of options. So he went work for hire, for his leader. We find out what actually happened to the full story of Layla's father. He explains that he was on a site in Egypt with an old partner named Bushman, and that job was to raid an Egyptian tomb. But Bushman changed the plan, called for no witnesses, so he killed everybody. Mark stood up and fought him, but Bushman finishes him, and before he dies, he crawls to a statue of Khonshu, and he is about to end his life. Khonshu reaches out to him, and he makes him a deal. He can live or die, but if he lives, he becomes his hands, his eyes, and his vengeance, to bind his very being to Khonshu, and eradicate only the worst, those who deserve it. We do find out that Khonshu really has been manipulating Mark. Because of his so-called broken mind, Khonshu asks, do you swear to protect the travelers of the night, and bring my vengeance to those who would do them harm? And Mark says yes. Then Khonshu says, rise and live again, as my fist of vengeance, as my moon knight. But then, we go back to Tauret and her boat. She notices that souls are being judged, being condemned to the sands before their time, meaning they are not dead, but they are actually being judged while they are alive. And that is what Harrow was doing. He and Amit are judging people way before its time. She says, this is bad and evil, which is the perfect time for Mark and Steven to plead their case. So they need to get back to stop Harrow and Amit. However, there is a problem. If she sends them back, they will go back into the same body that was shot. And they can't really go back, because they are will die again. But if Khonshu is brought back, he can give Mark and Steven the Moon Knight suit, which would heal them. Steven asks her if she can send word to Layla to help free Khonshu. And that way, Tauret can send them back to a healed body. But there are two problems. One is that the scales still aren't balanced, which means they could still be stuck in the underworld. And two, they have to go through Osiris's gates to get back. so Tarette steers her ship towards the gates. But she tells Mark and Stephen to go back inside and reveal these hidden things. Stephen knows that the big secret will be in the bedroom that Mark didn't want him to go. But Mark begs him to not go there again, and he will tell him everything. Stephen tells Mark that if anything happens, it will be his fault. Which in turn makes Mark nervous. He screams until we get to Harrow's office again. Harrow explains, reliving these kinds of traumatic memories can be so painful. Asks Mark, do you think you created Stephen to hide from all of the awful things that you feel you have done in your life? Or do you think Stephen created Mark to punish the world for what your mother did to you? So, there is only one way to know, that he has to open up to Stephen. Then we go back to the room. Mark's mother is banging on his door, trying to break through, because she is about to punish him. Mark is not wanting to deal with his mother. Surprisingly, we see Mark bring Stephen to life. So the big secret was that Stephen is actually the persona and the identity that is made up. Stephen was brought to life because he was the part of Mark that was supposed to be happy and carefree and not have to worry about life. But then there's also another major reveal, which is the fact that Mark's mother is dead, which we really wonder, who was he talking to on the phone this whole time? After the funeral of his mother, Mark sits outside of a house where people are gathered to mourn the loss of his mother. He decides not to go in. His father tells him to come, but he simply walks away. And this time is supposed to be where a person embraces and discusses their loss. But Mark doesn't want to deal with, and that's actually why he invented Stephen and brought Stephen to life. So instead of dealing with it, Stephen comes out. And he has no idea where he is. He simply says, oh, I did it again. And what he thinks is just he is getting up at night and essentially sleepwalking. But he pulls out the phone, and it looks like he is talking to somebody, saying, I know, I did it again. But we know it's not his mom, because his mother is dead. We actually think that he could simply be talking to himself. Mark blames himself for going to the cave, but Stephen tells him, you were just a child, she was wrong, it wasn't your fault. Now they returned to the top of the ship, where unfortunately the scales aren't balanced yet, and Tarette says she's sorry. The underworld is essentially going to claim them theirs. And this is where we actually see people that Mark has killed before coming onto the ship to try and take him to the underworld and make him a permanent part. They are a little too much for Mark to handle. But Stephen realizes if Mark can handle it, he can, because they're the same person. And Stephen steps up and he saves the day. But unfortunately, it costs him his own life. And finally, the scales are balanced. Now Mark is facing his past. He used Stephen to cope with so much in life, but now he can no longer use Stephen. The rest of his journey is something that he has to do on his own. And now after Stephen has sacrificed himself for Mark, Mark has to go on alone. The scales are balanced, everything is out in the open. Stephen knows that he was the person that has been made. Mark knows that he created Stephen to deal with things that he didn't want to deal with, so he could kind of ignore them and just be happy as Stephen. But now he's faced all of that and is on his own. He quickly finds himself in the field of reeds, basically heaven. The episode picks up when Harrow shot Mark Spector and killed him. Harrow and his men pull Mark's body out of the water so they can grab Amit's Ashabti. Now he has everything to release Amit. Harrow says, I'm sorry, sometimes we need the cold light of death before we can see reality, and asks who wants to heal the world. His staff changes, instead of having two crocodile heads, which represent the head of Amit, now has only one, and the other side has turned into an axe. And during all of this, Layla is hiding. Harrow leaves the scarab on Mark's body. As we know, the scarab is actually a compass that points to Amit's Ashabti. And they leave for the Great Pyramid of Giza. After Layla says goodbyes to Mark, she picks up the scarab and knows where Harrow is because of the compass. On the way to the pyramid, Harrow is stopped by the Egyptian Patrol Agency. He knows that he now has greater power, so he doesn't worry about all of the guns pointing at him. And he automatically starts using his power to judge people, and all of them actually die. They are being judged prematurely. Some of them might not have even committed the sin that will condemn them to a bad judgment. So only one man is left, and he is deemed a good man by Harrow. Layla actually managed to sneak onto one of Arthur's trucks, pretending to be one of his followers. And her plan is to stab him to death. But the Egyptian goddess Taaret interferes by communicating with her through dead bodies. She relays to her that Mark could actually return. And he wants her to stop right now, cause Harrow is too powerful. In order to get rid of Harrow, they are gonna need Khonshu. She tells her to break his Ashabti in the Chamber of the Gods. And Layla also can be her avatar, cause Mark said wonderful things about her. However, she thinks that she can still do it on her own, so she continues to follow Harrow. The avatars and their gods have felt a disturbance, and some of the gods don't really know what is going, until the avatar of Hathor says someone is trying to release Amit. What Khonshu and Mark were saying in the very beginning is right, and this could have all been avoided. Harrow shows up, and says you are judges, not warriors. This doesn't need to happen. They start fighting him, but he defeats all of the avatars, and says, that was all so avoidable. Harrow then break through the statue to release Amit. And now she is released, but she doesn't actually know who Harrow is, and literally asks to whom do I owe my gratitude. He says your humble disciple, to whom you owe nothing. She says that his scales lack balance, because of what lies ahead of him. He justifies that he had hoped his penance might correct his imbalance, and accepts the scales, regardless of the outcome. It seems that Amit didn't actually give the staff to Harrow. He did say, it was given to her first avatar, which clearly is not him. Which means the power that he had, was simply inside of the staff that came from Amit. And Harrow accepts that he probably is going to die. He actually says, that there are his disciples out there, who worship and follow her, whose scales balance perfectly. But she delayed his death, says you are the one, who set me free. And you are the avatar that I need. Serve me, and you will find peace. Do not let the pain of the past control you. Harrow says as you wish, and he truly does believe in what he is trying to do, despite the fact that it's going to kill probably many people. Meanwhile, Layla manages to release Khonshu. He doesn't sense Mark Spector in this world, says he died fighting, no doubt. She says that he fighting your war. Khonshu says if Mark is gone, he needs an avatar, and he tries to get her to be his avatar, but she sees through his manipulative ways, and says no, because he turned Mark's life into a waking nightmare, says that Mark didn't trust you, so I don't trust you. They will work together, without her enslaving herself. Khonshu says to rebind Amit, only an avatar can do it. She again refused, so he goes. Meanwhile, Amit says, let's go cleanse the souls of Cairo and then the world. But Khonshu shows up, and she says, that time has been cruel to him. He warns her that he cannot allow her to proceed. But then we pick up where Mark is in the field of reeds, and Stephen is left behind in the sand frozen. It's revealed that is not an actual true paradise. Taaret says that he made it, the peace he has always wanted but never had. He is manifesting it, which is no danger, no loneliness or hurt. Mark wonders, how could he ever truly have peace? Knowing that Stephen was back there in the sand, he would not actually ever have peace, and this would never be a paradise for him. So he goes back to Stephen, who happened to be frozen in the sand, right in front of the gate of Osiris. He delivers a very heartwarming speech, saying from the moment you arrived, you saved me. I survived because I knew that I wasn't alone. And eventually, after he turns to sand glass as well, the two of them are resurrected. Their souls go back to the shot up body, and they go through the gate. During all of this, Khonshu tries to stop Amit himself. Amit says my path is set, same as anyone's. I'm here to bring balance. Khonshu asks, you speak of balance, yet you choose him. And that her avatar is a sinner. But she says that Khonshu jealous of his loyalty. He says loyalty, at what cost? An empty world for his disciples to inherit? Harrow cuts, don't listen, he only wants to keep you bound. They then have a massive god fight. But it seems Amit is more powerful than Khonshu, cause he doesn't have an avatar. Mark and Stephen are healed, and come back to life. Khonshu sense that Mark is in this world, so he disappears. And we see flashbacks from Mark's memory. Khonshu powers wrap them up in the Moon Knight robes, and they are ready to go to battle. But not before they renegotiate the deal with Khonshu. He tells Mark that Amit has been freed. He was not strong enough to stop her, and he needs his help. Stephen asks how's this whole new arrangement gonna work then. Khonshu says that he will release Mark and Stephen. Stephen is glad, they got what they want, and asks how they will get to Cairo. Khonshu says, "You forget, I am still the god of the night sky." Then he changes the sky, and Stephen gives the body to Mark. Meanwhile, the avatar of Osiris tells Layla that they need more avatars. Also, they need to trap Amit in a mortal body, not a statue, so she will be more vulnerable, and he dies. Hero notices them and destroys the chamber, trapping Layla inside. Layla calls out to Taharet, accepting her offer to be her avatar temporarily. On top of the pyramid, Hero casts a sign to Amit's disciples. They begin to judge everyone around them, sending all unbalanced souls to Amit. Amit grows to a gigantic proportion as she consumes more souls. Layla emerges in an outfit similar to Taharet, but with twin short swords and wings. Moon Knight flies to Hero as Amit watches on. Hero then fights Mark and Steven, while Khonshu manifests himself into a giant form to take on Amit. Hero is beating Mark, but Layla intervenes. As Hero recovers, Mark and Steven take turns greeting Layla. Hero's disciples show up and ready to fight, and Steven shows Layla some of the skill sets that they have. Amit and Khonshu debate the morality of each other's causes and ridding the world of sinners. Khonshu argues that the difference was that he waited until the sin was committed, whereas Amit acts in prejudgment. Moon Knight and Layla take on Hero and his men, with Steven and Mark swapping suits to show different powers. During the fight, Hero distracts Layla by scaring a group hiding in a van. She saves them, and is asked by one if she is an Egyptian superhero, which she confirms. Hero tells Mark that had Amit ruled, his brother never would have died, because she would have killed Mark before the act was committed. Mark watches Amit strike down Khonshu as Hero sticks his staff into his chest. He has another blackout, and comes to as he is holding Hero's staff to his unconscious head. Mark asks Steven if that was him, to which Steven replies, "Not a chance." Layla frees herself and asks Mark what happened. He tells her he blacked out and doesn't recall. However, she tells him she knows how to defeat Amit and orders him to bring Hero. He carries Hero to the chamber and lays him on an altar. Layla tells him that they can use the room to bind Amit to Hero's body. As Amit realizes what is going on, she implores Khonshu, who tells her it is over. Amit is bound to Hero, who warns that she will never be contained. Khonshu tells Mark to end her, and Mark prepares to kill Hero to do so. Layla reminds Mark that he is free to choose, even if Khonshu is demanding that he choose vengeance. Mark tells Khonshu that if he wants Amit dead, he should do it himself. Mark then demands that Khonshu release them, and Khonshu does it. We are brought back to Mark and Steven with Dr. Hero. Dr. Hero notices that Steven and Mark are still working together and they are still in sync, but they see blood coming from Hero's foot. And Mark says, "Hey, you see that, don't you?" And Steven says, "Yeah, I see it." And Hero is actually quite confused. He asks why he is bleeding. Now, this is a callback to the very first scene, where Hero breaks up glass, puts it in his shoes, and walks on them. But Mark and Steven realize that this is all in their head, and they choose to wake up. They are in Steven's apartment, again tied to the bedpost. And there are two goldfish now, and when he is trying to walk, he falls out of his bed, again. Sometime later, we see Hero is a patient at Sinkiewicz Psychiatric Hospital. He sits in a wheelchair, moderately sedated, and unable to pick up his own coffee cup. He is taken by a man in a black suit speaking Spanish. Hero notices dead bodies as he is wheeled out to a limousine. Khonshu is sitting there. He explains that he never released Mark, because Mark never fully understood how truly disturbed he was. Khonshu then introduces Hero to Jake Lockley, Mark's third personality, the murderous spirit of vengeance that took over in every blackout, the personality that always led the body back to the flat in London, and the personality that maybe bought the second goldfish. Every time we were shown something that didn't have an explanation, it was Jake. However, Jake shoots Hero with a silenced pistol two times before driving Khonshu away.
I would drive for miles out in the face.